In this step, we're going to scale the characteristic impedances of the shunt stubs. Now here is the prototype that we had from step 7. So in step 7, we realized the inverters using a pi arrangement of stubs. We saw that some of the stubs from our inverter realization were in parallel with some of the existing stubs from our hybrid resonators, and we needed to combine them. The result of step 7 is that we ended up with shunt stubs that had characteristic impedances that were too low. So Z01 and Z03 had characteristic impedances of 8.7 ohms, and Z02 had a characteristic impedance of 10.27 ohms. So we want the characteristic impedances of our shunt stubs to be between 30 ohms and 80 ohms. Now we could realize microstrip lines with characteristic impedances that were maybe 20 ohms and maybe as high as 100 ohms, but we really like them to be around about 50 ohms. We're going to have the greatest chance of faithfully reproducing the impedances when they're in that range. Of course, 50 ohms is the impedance that we like for our systems. For a typical substrate such as alumina with a permittivity of 10, a 50 ohm line has a width which is approximately the same as its height. And so our manufacturability is about the maximum we could hope for when it's about 50 ohms, and that is the system impedance that we're interested in. Our prototype from step 7 is shown here, and approximately the characteristic impedances of our shunt stubs, such as Z01 here, is the characteristic impedance of one of those resonators, one of those microstrip lines. Of course, there is coupling between the microstrip lines, and that pretty much is accounted for by the series stubs. Because of that, we know that we want the characteristic impedances of our shunt stubs to be in the manufacturable range of characteristic impedances for our individual microstrip lines. For manufacturability reasons, we would like the microstrip lines to have reasonable width. And on alumina, we want these characteristic impedances to be between 30 ohms and 80 ohms. And the impedances of the series stubs are mostly determined by the coupling of the individual microstrip lines. And so that characteristic impedance is really determined by the separation of those individual microstrip resonators. So let's see what we're going to do here. So we have three shunt stubs. The Z01 and Z03 stubs have the same characteristic impedance. Z02 has a different one, and we want these characteristic impedances to be between 30 ohms and 80 ohms. So if we look at the lowest one, the Z01 characteristic impedance, we could scale the impedances in our circuit so that that 8.7 ohm went up to 30 ohms. Or looking at the larger one, the Z02 characteristic impedance, we could scale things such that that 10.27 ohm went up to 80 ohm. Well, a good choice is let's take that higher impedance line up to 80 ohms. So we're going to scale it to 80 ohms. To scale it to 80 ohms, that is increasing things by around about a factor of 8, we're going to have to scale the impedances of every element in that circuit by the same factor. Here is the prototype after step 7. We're going to multiply all of the impedances by a factor of 80 over 10.2715. And we're going to end up with this prototype at the end of this step. Now, the central shunt stub has a characteristic impedance of 80 ohm. Of course, that's what we decided to do. One of the consequences of this is now we have rather large source and load impedances. In summary, this is our step 8. We will have to do something in the next step to address that 389.426 ohm impedance. Because, of course, we want to use this in a 50 ohm system.